The next thing he had boldness.
Yeah.
How many said, God, you send me, I'll go.
Oh, yeah.
As soon as God lines you up in the right direction at 7-Eleven, you don't go into it. There's a big old man over there pumping the gas. God says, go for it, Master. I tell you what happened to me personally. And that's the only thing I can tell you. I can't tell you personally things that happened to you. But I was preaching my first revival. I was 19 years old. I think I told some of this a little bit. I had a little town called Louisville, Illinois. Just a little hick town. They had like 11 taverns in this town. It's way out in the country. And the odd thing about this town was that Hell's Angels bought out part of this town. And every year, twice a year, they would drive up from California. And they would possess this town for like 2 weeks straight. You wouldn't even want to go near this town. Huh? There's thousands and thousands and thousands of bikers. You didn't even want to go near that town. And this little preacher that was in our church got called in to pastor. He left the church. The pastor ordained him. He left the church and he rented an old fire station. They had the old horn on the outside. You know what I'm talking about? The old stations where they let off the siren and woo, all over the town. And I went there to preach one night. This pastor called me. Matter of fact, we had some words. And there were some feelings that were hurt. There were some offenses that took place. And I left the church, and he left and ordained and went to start a church. And hadn't heard from him in six months and a year, I guess. I was out evangelizing. And all of a sudden, I come home one night, and Mama said, you got a call from somebody. And I said, who? She told me, and I said, what in the world are they calling me for? And I went back in there and I called him back and he said, listen, and he was crying on the other line. He said, Brother Akers, he said, I did you wrong. And I said something offensively about you. And he said, I'm trying to pastor now and I'm trying to preach. And he said, I asked the Lord the other night to give me a great revival. And I began to pray for God to send me somebody. And the Lord said, I'll send you Pat, Brother Akers. And he said, I ask you for anybody for Brother Akers. And he said, that's the problem. He said, you're walking in a fence. And he said, you asked for forgiveness first. And he said, I guarantee you, I blessed your little town and I blessed your church. The problem is that when God says those things, we don't want to be obedient. Huh? Hello, God's calling.
Hello, God.
And I walked out of this building one night because we took some wires and we ran into the horn on the outside of this building. And I had my poster, and I still got found one the other day, a poster about this tall, and that when I had hair and had a beard, and I was traveling full time. Yeah, I had hair and a beard, and I was traveling full time. And had it out there. We took the wires. We hooked it onto the horn. And I preached that night. We had about 11 people. Had about 12 pews in this church. About half the size right here. That's about it. And I preached that night. And we had the microphone hooked up to the horn going outside. So we was going for about 4 or 5 blocks, honey. Well, down this whole main street was nothing but tavern after tavern after tavern. And that night when we got all done, I think all 11 people got saved and filled with the Holy Ghost. And we were starting revival great. I was excited, and the pastor was excited. And I come out there, and we're walking out the door, and I looked at the pastor, and I said, God, you asked me to do anything, I'll do anything you tell me. You asked me to say anything, go anywhere, I'll go. Have you ever said that before? And I come out that door and I said, God, I'll do anything you tell me to do. And I'll do anything you tell me. And I stepped out the door. When I did, I looked down. There was probably 1,500 choppers that were lined up down the street. And God said, okay, I want you to go down in the middle of all the boys down there, the men down there. He said, I want you to tell them about Jesus. I said, God, I'll do anything you want me to do, but go down there and tell those men about Jesus. And I began to turn around and begin to look for my truck. I had an old Suburban. And I began to look for him. When I did, one of them men had my poster in his hand. And he said, hey, preach. And I turned around and he said, this you? And I wanted to look at that poster and say, no, that's not me. I said, yes, sir, that's me. He said, when we started our vacation tonight, we're going to be here for 2 weeks. The last thing we want to hear is that garbage coming over that speaker. I would tell you to unhook it, but he said, you're going to do better than that. You're shutting down tonight, and you're leaving town. I looked at him, and I was angry inside. And I looked at him, and I said, yes, sir. I said, yes, sir. And I turned around and the pastor was there, and the pastor just heard me say, God, you asked me to do anything, I'll do it. Now, what kind of preacher would I be if I turned around and walked off after saying that? And that's what some of the people that you work with and some of the family members you know, they're asking you, waiting on you to come and talk to them. They're watching your life, and when you begin to mess up and do the things of the sin, they're wondering, what type of people are you? And I turned around and the Holy Spirit boldness kicked in me. And I looked at him and I said, Brett, sir, you think you're tough, don't you? And about three of them that stood like 6 foot trees looked at me and said, yeah, we are. And I said, yes, sir, I understand that. I said, but I dare you to come in my service tomorrow night right here at 7 o'clock in this little bitty old building. I dare. And they looked at me and they said, we'll be there. That night I went home and the pastor had fried chicken. And I walked home and had an old trailer out in the middle of the field hooked behind my Suburban. And Mama had fried chicken going on in there, the pastor's wife. And he said, you want some chicken? And the Holy Spirit said, you got your mouth in the suckling, boy. You better not eat tonight. You better lay on your face all night long and begin to pray for the mercy of God. I laid out there and cried like a baby. And all night long, I wasn't crying for the move of God. I was crying because what I said. I said, dummy, why did you say that to him? Why did you even open your mouth? I'll make a short story even shorter. I come to the church that night about 10 to 7. And they didn't there. And there's only one way in, one way out. They didn't have a back door. They didn't ask the pastor. And I was in that little building, had about 11, 12 people, about 3 visitors that night. And I thought to myself, my God, we're going to have revival. And about 5 till they weren't there, and I was starting to feel pretty brave. And I looked at the pastor, and I said, I knew they wouldn't show. They can't. Sometimes you better be careful what you say.
Yeah.
And I stood there that night and I said, they can't come against the anointing. 7 o'clock came and they started a little piano, started to worship. And I was worshiping saying, thank you, Jesus, for keeping them out of here. And about 15 minutes after 7, here comes these 3 guys that look like trees, walk in with 3 girls. These girls didn't have hardly no clothes on, and they're all black leather outfits. They came in and told the people in the back row, get up and move, this is our seat. I knew right then it wasn't going to look too good for the home team. That night, the Holy Spirit or the enemy hit me right there and said, you better find yourself a way to get out of here, boy. I looked back at all 3 of those men, and they looked at me, and they did this number. I knew right then they weren't playing. They were the real stuff. They were the real Hells Angels from California. They weren't some of these fake police by some iron on patch. I knew I was in trouble. As I began to preach, on the anointing, and the Holy Spirit said, don't you worry about them. You do what I tell you to do. You see, here's the problem. We try to get our spirit where our flesh is. We spend so much time trying to perfect the flesh when you need to kill that old flesh and let the spirit be and take its place. And I said, God, you're so right. And I began to come back and forth preaching on the anointing of God. I looked back there and all 3 of them heads ducked down behind them chairs there, ducked down. I thought to myself, my God, the flesh rolls up in me. Should they get ready to kill you? And I remember clear as day. I said, well, God, what a way to go. And I want you to know it wasn't 2 minutes later. I looked back and all 3 of those big old boys are standing up, tears running down their face. They come up there and they looked at me and they said, preacher, I don't know what you got, but we got to have it. Laid hands on us so good, anybody. Laid hands on those 3 men. They've slain out the spirit. I want you to know that was Tuesday night, or Monday night, Sunday night, the first night, Monday night. I want you to know what happened. The next night they come back and they had some more people with them. The next night they come back and they had some more people. Friday night I had 75 Hell's Angels all around this. I wish I'd had videos back then. Had 75 Hell's Angels all around inside. Honey, we had a revival that broke out. Not only did it break out there, we went to the community high school to an atheist pastor, principal, and he went to live Bible study in school, and he signed an agreement that we could have Bible study, and we had prayer on the campus. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm telling you, when you begin to walk in the boldness of the Holy Spirit. I'm not telling you to be stupid in the flesh. I'm talking about the boldness of the Holy Spirit. There's something different about that. When God begins to tell you and he begins to put a pointer on you, you better be obedient, especially when you say, I do whatever you tell me to do. I go wherever you tell me.
Amen.
Quickly, the other thing he had was compassion. Can't tell somebody about the love of Jesus if you don't love
him. That's right.
He had humility. Mm-hmm. He had obedience.
Yes.
Receptivity, sensitivity to guidance. Tact and enthusiasm. After each hindrance, there's things that will affect your witnessing. I'm just type a few of these down. Listen to this. Spiritual lethargy. If you're not excited about something, chances are you won't tell many people about it. Pastor, I don't know why we can't build a church. Well, I tell you what, let's just stop this week and let's just ask yourself. How many did you get to witness to?
Mm-hmm. Come on now.
Well, Pastor, I don't know why we ain't got nobody coming in. When's the last time you invited somebody? Do you know what I hear?
That's right.
Well, that's the pastor's job.
No,
is it? I think it'll be everybody. For many Christians, the excitement of the Christian walk has been dulled by everyday distractions. Materialistic pursuits and unconfessed sins. Like the believers in Ephesus, these men and women have left their first love. How does it affect your witness? How about lack of preparation? Personal dedication to Christ and understanding how to witness and what to say are imperative. Preparing your heart through prayer gives you the right attitude and opens yourself to the power of the Holy Spirit. How does it affect your witness? How about fear of men? We probably will be persecuted by unbelievers as well as believers, but the fear of man will prove to be a snare. Christ said of those who feared to confess his name, they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God. How does it affect? Well, I'm afraid of what he says. Would you tell him if you knew he's in the house that was burning up? You could get him out. I had one man that I was living around for a long time, and I'm going to get ready to this last day go over here. Same news. And I worked around him for almost 3 years. He was a backslidden deacon in an old church of God. He got hurt. Said he'd never go back to church again. He's out for, I said 3 years, about 11 years. Bitter pain. The daughter asked me to come home and help him with some drywall money. I walked up and knocked on the door and I said, hey, sir, I said, you want to know if I can help you drywall this room? He looked at me and he said, what do you want? I said, really nothing. He said, well, then I can't pay you much. I said, I asked you for pay. I just want to come help you. I worked for him for almost 7 years. Every time I'd get one thing done, he'd say, well, I got something else over here you can do. Come on around next week. I worked for him for almost 7 years. About a year and a half, 2 years after I started for him. 2:30 in the morning, I was popcorn in the ceiling. Everybody was in bed. Had scaffolding set up. He pulled up a bucket and he said, sit down, preacher. First time he ever called me preacher. I sat down on the bucket and I looked at him and he said, why did you ask me to church? I looked at him astonished. He said, why haven't you asked me to church? I looked at him and I said, would you have came if I asked you? He said, absolutely not. I said, I guess that's why I didn't ask you. I said, well, since you brought it up, what's it going to take to get that old bitterness out of your heart? 2:30 in the morning, tears running down the old dusty drywall face, old man. I want you to know for the next 4 years that I was with him, it didn't matter where I was preaching and singing, he was with me. He got back into the church that he felt hurt in. He was one of the most biggest financial givers. I see that man sometimes when they had something he needed, He went out and got a loan from the bank, brought the money in and made it.